In 1805, 100 British pounds could buy you quite a bit. After all, an average male laborer made about 12 pounds annually, and a bailiff might earn 20. Those same pounds in 1805 translate to 8,688 British pounds today, or right around 12,000 US dollars. So in 1805, when London cutler and swordsmith Richard Teed offered a remarkable 100-pound sword, it was not a project he assumed lightly, nor a weapon for the undeserving. Teed offered three grades of sword, 30-pound swords for midshipmen, 50-pound for lieutenants, but the 100-pound variety was reserved for captains. They were the richest and most elaborately decorated and came in a handsome mahogany case with a scabbard, knot, and sword belt. From the gilt bronze hilt and carved ivory grip to the tip of their etched, gilded, and blued 30 1/2-inch blades, they are awash in classical symbolism, centered around several key motifs, aptly summarized by a label provided by Richard Teed found inside the sword's caselet. It reads, "The ornamental design for the hilts of the swords, present from this fund, in reward of British valor, imports that national union, figured by the Roman fasces, produces Herculean efforts, of which the club of Hercules is emblematic, which aided by wisdom, denoted by the serpent, lead to victory, implied by the skin of the Nemean lion, the proudest of that hero's trophies. The wreath of the laurel denotes that rewards await the brave who shall successfully wield their swords in the cause of the country, in defense of British security, independence, and honor. One side of the blade is absolutely ablaze in niter blue and gold, depicting such figures as Britannia and Hope, amidst a host of patriotic and period embellishments, including the mark of King George III. The obverse is equally saturated, but with a section in the middle reserved for the golden text bearing the deeds and name of the recipient. As one might assume, there are high expectations for such an exceptional weapon's accoutrements. These are more than up to the challenge. The sword knot continues the sumptuous blue and gold theme. The sword belt is practically overgrown with floral embroidery, while its gilt hardware takes every opportunity to continue the symbolism shown on the blade. And while those are both worthy of note in their own right, they pale in comparison to the artistry shown on the scabbard. An exhibition of gilt brass or ormolu ornamentation, it bears two insets of naval and classical trophies with a deep blue backdrop, as well as three relief cast scenes, one depicting Hercules besting the Nemean lion, another of Hercules fighting the Hydra, and the last showing Britannia holding a laurel while directing two British squadrons against the Franco-Spanish line during the Battle of Trafalgar. Now, that last scene may sound a bit specific and out of place amidst the other imagery of antiquity, but it happens to be exactly what this sword was issued for. In 1803, the Lloyd's Patriotic Fund was founded by a group of businessmen to provide pensions and grants to wounded servicemen or the families they left behind. Additionally, they also presented items of merit to those officers of the Royal Navy who had performed with distinction in their course of duties. They issued silver vases, cash, and of course, the three grades of exquisite presentation swords. Only 175 Richard Teed swords were issued in all grades before the program ended in 1809, and extremely few are in private collections, especially outside the United Kingdom. So what did a man have to do to earn such a beautiful and valuable treasure? Just keep the French from invading Britain. In a series of on-again, off-again wars, in 1803, Britain and France saw the dissolution of the Treaty of Amiens and renewed their hostilities. By 1805, The British were enforcing a rigorous naval blockade and defending their own shores, while Napoleon Bonaparte's armies of the French Empire dominated most of Europe. Napoleon knew he would have to clear the English Channel of the mighty British Navy and smash their blockade before he could invade England. And so, the stage was set for a mighty naval battle, the Battle of Trafalgar. There, a fleet of 33 French and Spanish ships, containing almost 30,000 men and over 2,500 guns, formed the line to face 27 British ships, housing 17,000 men and over 2,100 guns. Napoleon, while a genius on land, was relatively inexperienced with naval strategy. He had also commanded a group of officers who saw their brightest and best either executed or dismissed during the French Revolution. The Franco-Spanish fleet may have had the upper hand in numbers, and of course much larger ships, but they would need them against the experienced and well-trained British Navy. On the morning of October 21st, the Franco-Spanish fleet is in two lines off the Spanish Cape of Trafalgar, just northwest from the Strait of Gibraltar. However, their maneuvering and some troublesome winds meant that what should have been two uniform lines were now two stretched, sort of irregular arches. While typical naval warfare of the era would have seen the two lines of ship pass each other, offering broadsides as they went, Admiral Lord Horatio Nelson was not a typical commander. To negate the superior numbers of his foe and to play to British strengths, he intended to sail two columns of British ships directly into the Franco-Spanish line. Once in the lines, it allowed him to rain hell on the surrounded middle section, obscure signals from the enemy's flagship, and to force the remaining sections on the outside to reposition their ships. However, this strategy would require the British to sail directly into their opponent's broadsides without the ability to answer. In preparation, he had his ships painted yellow and black in order to avoid friendly fire and the fracas to come. And he ordered the fleet to unfurl every sail to close the distance between the two fleets at maximum speed, another tactic that broke from typical naval warfare. At 11:45 that morning, Nelson ordered a flag signal that said to his fleet, "England expects that every man will do his duty," a phrase that endures in Britain to this day. The British ships began their perilous sprint directly into a superior force. The British ships crashed into the Franco-Spanish line, and nothing short of absolute thunderous chaos ensued. Raking broadsides were exchanged without pause. D-masted ships floated helplessly. Men fired with small arms from the decks. Smoke filled the sea air. Savage hand-to-hand combat ensued, and decks were smeared with the crimson stain of life. British discipline and experience ruled the day, as did their superiority in ship-to-ship fighting. And by the end of the battle, the Franco-Spanish fleet had lost 22 ships, and the British had lost none, though their flagship, HMS Victory, was disabled and had to be towed back. This decisive British victory marked the end of the French threat of invasion, and with the coming advent of steam power, exploding shells, and Ironsides, it was to be the last great sea battle under sail. Never again would sailed ships meet in such numbers. It also brought the death of legendary Admiral Nelson, who was killed by a French sharpshooter. Remarkably apropos that the death of such a brilliant naval tactician, leader, and sailor heralded the end of an era that he helped define. One of Britain's greatest military heroes, it is said that he passed 3 hours after being shot, only after hearing that victory was assured. This historic masterpiece sword, paid for with the blood of his countrymen, was presented in 1805 by the Patriotic Fund at Lloyd's to Captain Robert Redmill of the HMS Polyphemus for, quote, "his meritorious services in contributing to the signal victory obtained over the combined fleets of France and Spain off Cape Trafalgar on the 21st of October, 1805. It lives as a glimmering monument, not only of a momentous British victory, but also of the pinnacle of sailed fighting ships. It is a shining symbol of its era, which rightfully harkens back to those legends of antiquity who showed the same dedication to duty, dauntless courage, and thirst for victory.